and we're going to see you back soon. Rick, thank you very much.
Cheers.
Best. All right, next up, we've got a brand spanking new startup that's going to be giving us some awesome info about how we can be thinking about architecture on Kubernetes. So without further ado, if I can get Abhi, if you can share your... Very good. What's up, man?
Hello.
We just met each other last week, and we also just figured out that we went to the same university. Go UC Santa Barbara Gauchos.
Go Gauchos.
Very, very good to have you with us. Very good to have you with us. I don't know if Michelle is going to be joining as well, but he can hop in if he wants. Sure. So anyway, go right ahead, man. It's your time. Take it away.
Absolutely. Yeah, let me start sharing right here. I didn't know there was a... There was a template for the...
Oh, you're all good, man. Yeah. We accept any kind of artwork. Don't worry.
Okay, beautiful. Let's get started. All right. Are we good?
Yes, we are. Go for it.
Awesome. So I'm Abhi. I work at Airbyte. Let's get started. What is Airbyte? Airbyte is essentially three pieces of containerized software that come together as an open source data integration platform. Our first container is going to be a source connector. This will essentially be responsible for one thing, and that is to read data from anywhere. This is coupled with our destination connector, which is responsible for writing data to anywhere. So essentially, we'll be reading from anywhere, such as an API, a file, a relational database, and we'll be writing to wherever, a file, data warehouse, data lake, classic data integration pipeline setup. These two connectors on the sides are going to be maintained to be as simple as humanly possible. And then in the middle, we have an Airbyte worker, which is going to be connecting the two. This will manage the relationship and will consume basically data from the source connector as a message stream, and then kind of relay this message stream along to our destination connector. This is kind of a quick overview of how Airbyte works. And naturally, this can get a little hard to manage when the classic deployment of Airbyte is on a single node. Now, one thing that we're really going to get into here is about how to kind of modernize and make your deployment on Kubernetes flexible. Now, we started off kind of with a single node deployment where we're essentially putting all of our containers into one single node. So you can imagine that if you're at a big company, or if you know someone that's a big company, you're going to have a lot of sources and a lot of destinations. So that's going to kind of make it really hard to scale up one single server individually. And you're going to have to, instead of having a nice classic horizontal scaling story, you're going to have more of a vertical scaling story where you're just going to have to keep beefing up one instance. So one thing that we do want to consider is before we're moving to Kubernetes, because this kind of classically solves that problem of horizontal scaling, is we want to be prepared for it. And something that we wanted to kind of value as an open source project is keeping our containers and our software as simple as humanly possible wherever we can. And that's why in our source and destination containers, we've made the behavior extremely, extremely simple. This is going to be really important. And I think this concept and this value of keeping containers as simple as humanly possible is really what's going to enable you to have this composability and to have this flexibility when you are managing your deployments and maybe you're rethinking your architecture. One of the really important things, and I think one of the biggest values to this, especially as an open source project, is that it actually makes it a lot easier for people to contribute to us. Being able to contribute and to basically create custom source and destination connectors, and kind of as an open source product, like showing that that is kind of easy for your for users to get involved, is extremely, extremely important. Now we have these really simple pieces in our source and destination. Now what this allows us to do is we can load as much middleware and complex logic into this Airbyte worker that's managing the relationship between both of these connectors. And we'll see that in our architecture right here. We can basically start with moving from our single node design. We can start with perhaps a single pod design. And we will basically keep all of these containers on one single pod. We'll have a source connector, a Airbyte worker, and a destination connector all living on one pod. Now, what this immediately gives us is this gives us horizontal scalability in terms of the fact that we can basically provide our underlying Kubernetes cluster with basically a node pool, or that is a lot easier to manage than maybe a single node deployment on a server. This is natural. This is one of the benefits that many people understand when they're coming to a Kubernetes style deployment. And one thing that we don't lose also going over from maybe a classic deployment to our deployment on Kubernetes is that we get to talk over a local network. This is also pretty fairly well understood. And naturally, we get to take advantage of the awesome Kubernetes scheduler, which is going to be doing a lot of the heavy lifting for us, because there's going to be a lot of combinations. If you have a lot of sources and you want to move data from a lot of sources to a lot of destinations, you might have a lot of combinations of sources and destinations. So having all of this scheduled for you is going to be really useful. Now, what is kind of the main point of this is that we wanted to talk about how making your containers simple will allow you to kind of perform a lot of really cool things. And here is kind of, if we zoom into this design that we had on the previous slide, this is kind of going to illustrate that very well. We can see that once we move data from our source connector to our worker container can now perform a lot of in-flight operations. Our worker container can maybe look at our replication streams. It can like look at the telemetry on a replication stream and pass that to a process outside the pod and give you metrics metadata. It can maybe look that and see that the destination connector is not consuming data as fast as it possibly could. So then maybe it can apply back pressure and send some of the buffer the message data, whether that's in a attached local persistent volume, whether that's in a cloud persistent volume, whether that's maybe in an S3 bucket. This could be configurable. We could maybe do in-flight data privacy checks and data validation. Now, what this architecture really allows you to do, as I think I display here, is essentially push all of this really complex logic into the worker. And that's, I think, something when you're really trying to like take advantage of like a Kubernetes style deployment, moving all of this complex logic, I think isolating it to one container is super valuable. And that is essentially what allows us to look into very flexible ways we can kind of, I guess, display our architecture. And I think being prepared for that before you kind of say, okay, we're Kubernetes viable, or we can deploy into Kubernetes, I think it's really important for any project really consider this and see how you can change and see how you can think about your architecture in many different ways, because obviously many people are going to have different use cases and many people are going to be thinking about things differently. So making it as composable as humanly possible is one of the most important things. And we can see that because we can look at a scenario in which maybe our previous architecture doesn't solve every use case. We can address the elephant in the room here, and we can very clearly see that if we have many source and destination combinations of, let's just say that we are writing from a Salesforce API, we're writing from a Postgres database into one Postgres database, a Stripe API into the same Postgres database. All of these three sources are going to be connected to the same destination connector. So in every Kubernetes pod that we instantiate for our respective source and destination pairs, we are going to be re-instantiating this destination connector three times. This naturally leads to some inefficiency, even though that we're pretty confident in our previous architecture. The beautiful part is because we've left our containers to be really simple, we've left our kind of deployment really flexible, we can then use this power to maybe compose it in a different way. We could then optimize for efficiency instead of reinstantiating our containers and we could just have a source worker and a destination worker. Now, what this takes advantage of is we have our extremely simple, I'm going to keep saying this, we have our extremely simple source connector container, and that could be co-located alongside a source worker. And that could be talking basically between pods of to a destination worker, and that's living alongside the destination connector. Naturally, there are going to be some pros and cons that come with this approach. We are going to probably see a lot of network pressure on that one destination worker. There's going to be a lot more pods that are going to probably try and get in contact with the destination worker. So you'll probably have to have some kind of like replication story around that. So we can see that we can adjust our architecture in order to basically accommodate for different use cases. We keep kind of this the individual parts really simple. And that's kind of like this, I think this may be kind of a straightforward thing to a lot of people, but I think just this is, I think, one piece of tech that can really kind of help you when you're going forward, is just kind of thinking about how can I make my software and my containers more simple so that I can maybe enable Kubernetes to be kind of this, like a more, you just make it like more composable and make it more flexible. And obviously, like if we look at like the previous V2 architecture, we can see that we had all of these really awesome in-flight operations and all of these complex operations being done on the worker. And unfortunately, when we go to this model, we have to actually split up those responsibilities across the source and the destination worker. But again, because we've left a lot of these responsibilities to that worker, we can actually really cleanly split these responsibilities across the workers. So to kind of wrap up, keeping your containers as simple as possible is kind of a really awesome kind of strategy in order when we're kind of looking at deploying onto Kubernetes, when you're kind of preparing to say that you support it. This is a really awesome way to keep your deployments composable and to keep them flexible. This is also really important if you're an open source project that is relying on community contributions to basically support different, in the way that we do, to basically support different sources and destinations, but in your case, it may be supporting them in a different way. So this keeping containers simple essentially is one of the keys to deploying on Kubernetes in a flexible and manageable fashion. Thank you. That'll be all.
Absolutely awesome. Absolutely awesome. And you were able to get all that done in record time. That was incredible. for folks that don't know Airbyte is one of the coolest things that's happening right now. They have a Slack that is absolutely on fire. This is not just hype, is that people are really engaging and really embracing the open source mentality about trying to do things in a simpler way, exactly as you just explained. So I think that was wonderful. And I feel like I'm saying this every time, but we need to plan a proper meetup to do a deeper dive on this.
Absolutely.
To really get into the weeds. But anyway, I think that was phenomenal. And to get all that done in about 14 minutes, hats off to you. Anyway,
we
both went to a great university, and it's no surprise. So anyway, that'll be all for right now. Thank you very, very much for your presentation. And now we'll be moving on to the next one. But anyway, cheers. Thank you.
Cool. Thank you.